So let me say good evening to all of you and welcome to Real and Rational, the 2020 MoMath Gala. My name is Cindy Lawrence. I'm the Executive Director of the National Museum of Mathematics. And I'd like to start by thanking our prime patrons for the evening, Jim and Marilyn Simons, John and Laura Overdeck, and the Fry Family Foundation. Thank you. I also want to thank MoMath's Board of Trustees, many of whom are with us today. If we were live, they'd all stand up. Since they can't do that, I will suggest that everybody choose gallery view in your Zoom window so you can see all the faces. And I'll ask, if you're a trustee, please turn on your video and wave. And we will acknowledge all of you with a virtual round of applause. Thank you. Since it opened 8 years ago, MoMath has welcomed more than 1 million people, and it has become a model for museums around the country. But like most museums, in the middle of March, we closed its doors to the public. But we were ready. We'd been playing what if for weeks, and that allowed us on the very last day that we had our in-person school groups to also offer our very first day of online offerings. And since that time, we've hosted almost 2,000 events, reaching more than 50,000 people in more than 100 countries and every state. It turns out that math is a pretty universal language, and one that has helped many people around the world make human connections, even as many of us are still sheltering at home. At a time when divisiveness seems to have become all too common, MoMath is working hard to unite people of all ages and all backgrounds over a shared enjoyment of mathematics. Hopefully what you see on your screen now is the word mathematics, and I've chosen to illustrate it in shiny gold letters, expressing that math to me has both a shimmering beauty and also deep intrinsic value. But this illustration goes a little farther than that. If you look, you think you're seeing flat letters on your screen. If we look at a slightly different angle, you can see that the letters have some dimension to them. And this is true of mathematics too, that sometimes if you look at something from a slightly different angle, it gives you the ability to see things from a new perspective. And sometimes you can gain insights that maybe weren't obvious at a first look. So you may have thought you were looking at flat letters on the screen. I showed you there was some perspective, but if we look even more closely, you'll find that it's even more relevant for tonight, because tonight we're not just talking about mathematics, but we are having a celebration of mathematics. And so what you may have thought was just a simple representation of a word, a familiar word on the screen, actually, when we look at it from different angles, has a lot more interest to it. It's a lot more complicated than you might have thought. And equally, math gives us the ability to see things differently and hopefully sometimes to surprise and delight us. With that, I would like to invite the chairman of the MoMath board, John Overdeck, to say a few words. John is the co-founder of Two Sigma, as well as one of the founding trustees of the museum. He and his wife, Laura, have championed math-related causes and are doing much to make the world a better, more equitable place. Please join me in welcoming John Overdeck.
Thank you, Cindy, and thanks to all of you for joining us in this special program this evening and for your support of MoMath. As Cindy mentioned, I'm John Overdeck, and I have the unique pleasure of serving as our board chair. What a year it has been. Many of us would have looked forward to sharing this evening together under the vaulted ceilings of Guastavino's, but instead, most of us today find ourselves at home. This year, our lives have been disrupted in incalculable ways. Tangibly, the museum's doors have been closed since early March. In the meantime, some of us here tonight have suffered inestimable personal losses. For those of you have our sympathies and love. In this context, your resilient presence here tonight inspires us as we come together to celebrate MoMath's mission and impact. Amidst the hardships of 2020, there is light to celebrate, as Cindy mentioned. thanks to generous supporters such as you and to the commitment of the hardworking educators, both on MoMath staff and from the broader mathematical community, we've seen great progress this year. Over the last 8 months, MoMath has held regular virtual classes and events, bringing world famous mathematicians into children's homes in over 70 countries. MoMath has brought together the community to sponsor new programs that encourage more diverse faces to see the beauty of math, a passion that should know no demographic boundaries. A few weeks ago, I had a great pleasure of spending a few hours exploring MoMath's new history of mathematics page, developed in partnership with Wolfram Research. From interactive exhibits showcasing Babylonian arithmetic to explorations of the Pythagorean theorem on papyrus, this new project invoked some of the joy I felt as a kid. My hope is that today's children can see that same excitement and that MoMath can be the fulcrum upon which much of that discovery rests and rotates. In all of its work, MoMath continues to play a leading role, taking math beyond the classroom and sparking curiosity and revealing the fun in mathematics. Making math fun and encouraging children and adults to experience math from the early ages throughout life is essential if we want to have a diverse workforce with the math skills and knowledge we need to succeed. MoMath's work is just beginning, and the need for it to continue and expand is great. Even before COVID, studies showed that the math prowess of our country has been dimming. And under these COVID conditions, the latest research from NWEA estimates that for students in grades 3 through 8, average learning will drop by half from what we would expect under normal conditions. Facing this challenging and uncertain future, it's good to hear tonight from some deep and wise thinkers. It's an honor for me to introduce our next two speakers, two true luminaries, both of whom I've had the pleasure of joining on the board of the Institute for Advanced Study, Eric Schmidt and Manjul Bhargava. Both need little introduction to this group, and both are worthy of long ones, and I'll try to split the difference. Eric is an accomplished technologist, entrepreneur, and philanthropist. Although those titles don't do justice to the role Eric has played in shaping the world in which we live. After earning his PhD in computer science from Berkeley and an already distinguished career as a programmer and technology leader, Eric joined Google Alphabet in 2001, serving as its CEO and later as its executive chairman. Under more than 16 years of his leadership, Google dramatically scaled its infrastructure and diversified its product offerings while maintaining a strong culture of innovation and redefining our relationship with the internet. Eric has written widely about his experiences and lessons learned from Google, inspiring many of us. With his wife, Wendy, Eric has also been equally foresighted in his philanthropic and social initiatives. In recent years, the Schmidts have co-founded Schmidt Futures, a philanthropic initiative to help exceptional people do more for others by applying science and technology. And they've also committed over $1 billion to identify and support talent globally and across fields. In addition to philanthropic endeavors, Eric has generously advised and served a variety of esteemed organizations, among them the President's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology, the Department of Defense's Innovation Board, and NASA's National Space Council User Advisory Group. He currently chairs Governor Cuomo's Blue Ribbon Commission to reimagine New York after COVID. What a great treat it is to have Eric with us tonight to share stories of how math has affected his art and why he thinks it'll be vital to tackling our challenges going forward. Eric will be interviewed by Professor Manjul Bhargava. Manjul's inspired lifelong passion for math carried him to a full professorship at Princeton at 28 and to an illustrious range of honors. Most notably, Manjul was awarded the Fields Medal in 2014 for his breakthrough methods in the geometry of numbers. Manjul's work embodies the idea that mathematics is creative, elegant, and powerful, and can be used to analyze and solve real-world problems. Manjul has also worked hard to improve educational opportunity for all. While visiting MoMath and the Flatiron Institute, Manjul helped draft Indian Prime Minister Modi's revolutionary national education policy, which has led to a transformative increase in the investment in universal primary and secondary education in India. In 2018-19, he served as MoMath's inaugural distinguished chair for the public dissemination of mathematics, and he currently serves on our board of trustees. Beyond this, among other things, Manjul is an accomplished tabla player and a crafty magician. So now let me pass it on to Manjul, who will be interviewing Eric. Thank you everyone for joining us.
Well, thank you so much, John, for that very kind introduction. And thanks everyone for joining today and for your continued support of the National Museum of Mathematics during these difficult times for New York and for the world. And of course, thank you so much, Eric, for being here. It's great to see you. Alas, virtually again, but hopefully we'll see each other in person when all this passes. Hopefully that's soon. We're all grateful to your work, Eric, in leading the Governor's Blue Ribbon Commission to reimagine New York, which aims to, just reading the official mission of this Blue Ribbon Commission, is to employ lessons learned from the COVID-19 pandemic to improve and modernize New York State systems for the future. So thank you so much from all of us for your work on that. And so I guess I'll start with your experience on the commission and first ask what's on everyone's mind right now, which is, where are we in this pandemic in terms of our health and our economy and our recovery? And what should we all be doing as individuals and as a society as we transition to the new normal? And what is that new normal going to be? So
thank you, Manjul. Thank you, John. Thanks for all of my friends who are on the video. It's great to see everybody again. I'm very worried that the new normal for some people is near death. The reality of the pandemic is we do not have solutions that will resolve where we are for another 6, 9, 12 months, even assuming rollouts of vaccine at high rates and all sorts of optimistic assumptions about vaccination rates and so forth. So you have to have a strategy to get through the next year. And during that next year, the states are pretty much all bankrupt because businesses are not paying their taxes and so forth. And many of the industries which absorb relatively unskilled laborers, hospitality, travel, those sorts of things, have been hit terribly. So we've got fundamentally people like ourselves who can get through this. Most of you can work from home, or you have flexibility in how you work and your lifestyle, or you're retired or what have you. But for many people, an estimate is about 2/3, they don't have that option. And so they wake up every morning forced to go to work, not knowing if they're going to get exposed, not knowing if they're going to get a deadly disease. I think it's well understood now that roughly Caucasian people are hit at a certain rate, African-Americans are hit at twice that rate, and Hispanics are hit at 3 times that rate for all sorts of long set of reasons. So you have a public health crisis, you have an economic crisis, and I think we have a moral crisis. We've made the death rate of 800 people per day a new normal. How is that okay? It will never be okay to me that this is what's happening. So the long and short of it is, in our commission, we're working hard to work on broadband connection, because during this time, the most underprivileged do not have access to broadband. I was surprised at how many people, hundreds of thousands of families, do not have the basic capability of having their children learn remotely. School was the only place where they could get access to that. I mean, I can go on, but you get the idea. We're pushing hard on telehealth. At one point, about 85% of all the doctor visits were telehealth. They used to be 0.3%. And with this group, I can actually use percentages. And we're hoping that the stable situation will be a hybrid where there's a fair amount of telehealth visits and then some in-person visits. And if the economic system and the repayment system makes that happen, I think that's more efficient for everyone. We're also working on worker retraining and access. There's a problem now that you have an awful lot of people who are required, basically have to be in a local context, and they can't figure out what jobs are available for them. And there are a number of initiatives at the state level to try to address that.
Yeah, digital technology is definitely becoming much more central in everyday life. And that seems like that will likely be a part of the new normal.
Yeah, one way to say it is that the digital transformation that was going to take a decade has now happened in 1 year. And there are many things that are not coming back. So I'll give you an example. During my professional life, it was common for a salesperson to get on a 12-hour flight for a one-hour meeting. You can be sure that that travel has stopped and will stop for good. It's not a good idea on the other side. It's not a good idea for the salesperson. People are going to accept Zoom and Zoom equivalents as being as good as in person, at least for some activities. this has a profound impact. That's the little story on travel, because much of the profits of the travel industry are related to such travel, which is clearly going to be much lower. One of the questions is whether the foreign travel that drove our economy is going to come back. Throughout the summer, when infection rates were low in Europe and high in America, it was impossible for a European to come to New York City on vacation. What do foreigners do when they come to New York on vacation? They buy expensive stuff in Madison Avenue, right? So we've lost that. And now that the infection rate in Europe is higher than that in the United States, which is horrific, we can't do it anyway. So again, we missed another opportunity. I worry that this is not going to come back. I can list other things, but I think the fact of the matter is we will go back to work. We will go back to offices, but our behavior will be different. We will clearly not travel in quite the same way we did before, for sure.
But you mentioned there is a worry that the digital divide will get worse than those who have between those who have digital access and those who don't. And this lack of access will disproportionately affect the economically disadvantaged and people of color. How will we ensure that we're going in the right direction and giving equitable access to digital devices and connectivity as the world goes increasingly digital?
Well, so every state, and in fact, the federal government has programs that require, for example, telecommunications carriers to provide low-cost broadband access. And many of these policies are not broadly available, people don't know about them, and so forth. So the first thing to do is to make a set of regulatory changes that just make all of those things front and center for everybody. And it turns out that there are many NGOs, right, groups of well-meaning people who can help this. But the conclusion I came to is that you can't participate in the great bazaar that is America and have an opportunity without a broadband connection. I think it's a separate question. Once you have the broadband connection, the damage in terms of inequality in our country of the pandemic has been horrendous. Death rates, impact, scare, cultural, so forth and so on. So we talk a lot about the unfairness of our system. The pandemic has made it much worse. I'm assuming President Biden, assuming he is elected, will have this as a high priority because it's a traditional Democratic goal anyway. But the numbers are vast. There's an awful lot of people, millions and millions of people who've been affected by this. And that's why it's so difficult to deal with.
Right. Well, healthcare is also being deeply affected, and we're gradually moving towards telehealth. How will we ensure that telehealth is also available to all in an effective and equitable manner?
So in the American system, the most important thing are these, there's a name for them, these codes that are written on the slips, and that's how people get reimbursed. So the entire healthcare system of America is determined by the reimbursement rate for the service that you provide. So the number one thing to do is to make sure that CMMS and the appropriate state authorities who control Medicare, Medicaid within the state have an equal pay for telehealth and physical training. I'll give you an example. Physical therapy is today not compensated in the same way in person as it is remotely. And yet there's obviously things that you can do remotely from physical therapy that are better, especially since you don't really want people moving around that much. So this is the sort of conundrum. The president and CMMS actually announced that they were gonna do this, but they didn't plan to extend it after June of this year. So again, people are using temporary stopgap answers rather than saying what we want in the future is we want an equitable healthcare system, which encourages teleworking and so forth. It's safer and it's more efficient. And by the way, the medical profession is more efficient for them too. You have a choice of going to the doctor and waiting around and listening to Mrs. Jones and blah, 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 or you get in and you get out.
Right. Along the same lines, do we have plans in place to retrain workers? How are we going to retrain workers when, especially in underserved communities, when many jobs are now slowly being phased out or businesses are going out of business?
I'm sorry to be so critical, but this is an area that's really poorly served right now. You say, well, that's of course LinkedIn, but many of the people don't know how to use LinkedIn or they can't figure out where their job category is in their neighborhood and so forth. So there's a set of organizations that are trying to address this. They're trying to get all the curricula in one place, getting, you know, resource centers and things like that. Many of the people who are using this are not particularly deft at computer skills. So for us, we'd say, well, just search it, you'll figure it out, and so forth. Many people are unable to do that, and they need help. And we need to provide that help for them.
So digital training, computer training.
Yeah, and it's pretty simple stuff. And there's plenty of people who will volunteer to do this.
Okay. Yeah, as the world moves towards becoming a more digital one, many countries are investing heavily in artificial intelligence, and they're actually using a lot even during this pandemic for contact tracing and face recognition. So they're investing heavily in AI. How are we doing in the US on this front? Are we doing enough?
Well,
are robots going to take over the world post-pandemic? And if so, whose robots are they going to be?
So I head the National Security Commission on Artificial Intelligence for the US. It's created by Congress. So we've looked at this very carefully. At the moment, the United States is ahead in AI, and China is very close following us. And the question of competition of China is the defining question after the pandemic. Because China has indicated the markets that it wants to compete in. And I'll read you the list, but it's basically everything that we care about. Let's see, here's the list. Quantum communications, supercomputing, aerospace, 5G, mobile payments, new energy vehicles, high-speed rail, financial technology, and artificial intelligence. Well, that's the entire universe of everyone on this call, right? So if you're not aware of it, China is coming straight at the core industries that are the economic growth engines for America. Now, it's not time to panic. It's time to get our act together. And so whether you call it a strategy to compete with China or whether you call it a national innovation strategy, I don't care. But we need to prioritize the industries which start with AI because AI is so transformative to do this. In America, AI is being used for vaccine development, various forms of, and there's been tremendous process, as Julie was talking about earlier, tremendous process in the synthetic biology and in drug discovery and so forth and so on. It's remarkable progress. But the systems to do sensor systems, essentially sentinel systems that look for things and give you early warning, are not possible because we don't collect the data. Literally, we don't know at a national level or at a state level where the cases are, what's going on in the hospitals, and so forth. I defy you to get all that data. It's in all sorts of pockets, and there's no way to put it together. And without having an integrated data strategy, you can't use AI to do the machine learning to learn the things that you described. By the way, this is an example, and there are many things wrong with China, but this is an area where China is ahead because they have such national databases and they don't care about personal privacy, so people can just mung the databases together. China has announced a very, very large effort on the biobank area. So that's an example of the kinds of things that they can do that are harder for us. And of course—
Who has to take the lead here? Who has to take the lead here in the United States? The government, industry?
I think the conclusion you come to in America after watching the abysmal performance of our country is that the states are well-meaning, but they're essentially, they don't have any money. All the money they take, they spend. And there are issues with raising taxes and so forth and so on. And yet the federal government seems to be able to spend money with impunity, right? Without a negative cost, at least for the moment. And this has been true for quite some time. And so the conclusion you come to is if you need money, it has to come from the federal government. And that tells you that if you want to do the kinds of things I'm describing, there has to be a federal program with private industry partners. So the genius of the American system, which all of us went through, is these extraordinary universities, right? 17 out of the top 20 universities in the world are in the United States. We are the primary educator of foreign students, which of course the Trump administration is trying to get rid of, which is idiotic. There's a long list of idiotic things, but the fact of the matter is the genius of America is the federal system overspending, putting that money into the hands of universities, research labs, and private industry to invent this future. This is how all of the invention that was created by the mathematics that you all did became, right? It's always been true. It's the chip, GPS, the phone, you name it. cracking, to pick another one.
Right. Well, to tie the problem you're mentioning to what's going on now, other countries have used contact tracing and tracking apps effectively to slow the spread of COVID-19. Why has the US been slow in adopting such technology? And what can we do to change this?
So one way to think of this problem as a political problem is you have to solve three problems at the same time, not two. You have to solve the health problem, which is essentially getting people to not get the disease. If you don't get the disease, you won't die from it. This is not complicated. The second thing is economic growth, because without some form of economic growth, or at least economic stability, people go bankrupt, people are homeless, it's terrible. But the third one is this perception of freedom, the perception that the government is letting me live my life. And the three together represent an unsolvable problem. So let's talk about contact tracing. If you study what Taiwan did, if you get a case, what they do is they take your phone without your permission, I might add. They log all the people that you were anywhere near, and they take all of them and throw them in isolation or quarantine of one kind or another. And that's how you fight a disease like this. And they learned this from SARS. They don't have this debate over my phone and can the judge get access to it and so forth and so on. They take your phone, they look where you were, and there you are. And by the way, this works. So now imagine in America, Apple and Google did a very good thing. They built a low energy Bluetooth system, which anonymized the information and said you had been near someone who was subsequently tested positive. Why does this not work? Because mathematically, and again, you guys can do this in your head, think of the number of people that have to have this app voluntarily installed for it to be of any use at all if the test positivity rate is about 1%. In other words, the vast majority of people that you encounter don't have it, but you have to have a very large number of people who have the app, so it has to be mandatory. So now what's happened is Apple and Google have made that library available as a standard upgrade of their phones, but none of them want to force contact tracing because they'll get sued to death. So you see the problem in the American system, because it appears that no one is in charge or no one is willing to take the political risk to do something like Taiwan, which is invasive but will save lives. So to me, it's very straightforward. I appreciate you care a lot about freedom. I do too. Are you willing to give up some of your freedoms for a limited period of time in order to save 100,000 lives? I am. I vote for that choice.
Right.
And so if the leadership said, we're going to give everybody a choice, and it's okay if you decide to kill people, but I want an explicit vote that the things you care about are more important than the lives of your parents and grandparents, right? And I think that's the stark reality of this. And I'm ignoring the death rates of young people and all the other terrible things that are going on.
Right. We do have a COVID Alert New York app now, but I guess that's voluntary and just restricted to New York.
I would suspect that the vast majority of people on this Zoom call either were not aware of this or certainly don't have it installed. If it were mandatory in the United States, it would automatically have been installed and then it could be used. Again, there are ways of protecting your privacy and your anonymity. I would love to get a phone call saying, by the way, you were near somebody today, you should go get yourself checked. I believe in testing.
Why don't we have a national app? Why is it done statewide?
Well, the government, in particular the White House, made a decision sometime in March to not manage this federally. And I think, again, in history of the errors that were made, the lack of rapid testing is going to be one. The decision to federate the decision without the appropriate money to implement it, right? Because these things come with bills, pushing it on the states. And my initial reaction, just to show how wrong I was, I figured that's good. You know, it's a diverse country. We should allow this. The problem with this, first people move, right? So there's a great concern now in New York that people from Texas and Florida are going to return to New York and bring the disease with them. Right. It's a real concern, and you don't want to shut down that path.
Right. Well, the pandemic has really torn down trust in many realms, trust of the government, trust between states, trust between nations. What in the new normal will enable us to restore global trust, move towards greater unity and cooperation again?
We need some leadership here. And the leadership starts by a statement about our shared humanity. We have an enemy that is touching the whole world, that no one, it discriminates in favor or against all humans, as everybody knows. And yet we're not behaving as though we have a common enemy. We're also not behaving as though we have a common enemy in our political system. The fact that we're having inane arguments over something as simple as wearing a mask indicates to you something is very, very wrong. New leadership, right, in the form of, we're going to tackle this and you're going to have to give up some temporary freedom in return for getting this thing under control is needed. This is not a direct analogy, but if you think about the hostage crisis with President Carter, it took a new president to change the situation. And I think my personal opinion is that the political systems in democracies get caught in a certain lock. And because no one can ever admit that they made a mistake, they get stuck, right? So there are other diagnoses. For example, in Spain, I spent a fair amount of time in Spain this summer, the central government is weak. And so they federated the decision out. And some of the states made the right decisions. Some of the states made the wrong decisions. And the consequences were profound. Spain now has a horrific case because people went back and so forth. Madrid has been shut down. Everyone here is familiar with the situation in France where there's now a 9 p.m. lockdown in Paris. That's when they start eating, right? You can imagine what that's like. And in Britain, you have incoherent and inconsistent leadership from a man who got a very serious case of COVID. So I don't understand, but the answer ultimately is going to be leadership where we agree to a limited amount of shared sacrifice and we monetize the debts that the states have. We get these testing programs, contact tracing and programs, and we can win. And by the way, this is not science. This is not like what you guys do every day. We know how to do this. We choose, just to be totally brutal, we have chosen not to solve this problem. We have chosen to work on other things as a country, which I find not okay.
Yeah. Well, I think that's a good, nice note to end on about the pandemic.
Well, can I say one thing?
Yeah.
There is going to be a time when people realize that science is still true, that math is still correct, right? And that we need to have people who understand these things making decisions that affect all of us. I think all of us have a responsibility. I'm trying, and I know you all are trying. Mm-hmm. Let's get the message out that science and math are not optional. We have to operate under those rules, unfortunately. I wish I could wish cancer away, for example, but I don't know how to, right? These are just facts. And get back to business. And this is a great country. Let's get back to business.
Yeah, get back to mathematical and scientific thinking in our decisions. Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yeah, thanks so much, Eric.
Thank you all. Thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you, John, and the whole team. And I look forward to seeing you all soon.
It's always enlightening to hear insights. Look forward to seeing you again soon, including at the Physical Museum when it opens again.
Good. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Eric, for joining us. Great to see you.
Thank you, Eric.
Thank you, Cindy.
Thank you, Eric. Delightful.
And thank you, Manjul, as well, for the, really hosting a wonderful conversation. Now, what I'd like to do is bring up somebody else, my good friend and colleague, Anton Bakker. Anton is an artist who does a lot of very interesting sculpture work. And in fact, his work was meant to be on display in the museum this past spring. Of course, the museum closed in March, preventing that show from being physically installed. But Anton and the MoMath team were not to be deterred. And Anton recreated his entire show in a virtual gallery, which is a replica of the MoMath gallery. For those of you who have been to MoMath, when you visit the virtual show, you really do feel like you're walking through the MoMath gallery. And so please join me in welcoming my dear friend and colleague, Anton Bakker.
Thank you, Cindy. Thank you, MoMath. Thank you for the opportunity to share a bit of my passion and to say a word about what I do. Tonight, we will see various sculpture themes, mathematical sculpture themes, and we'll explore one of the sculptures a little bit in detail. The remaining sculptures are for you to explore, and maybe a little bit in the after party, But if you explore them on your own, I'll encourage you to press the blue buttons, because those are linked to more information and interactive sculpture models. Before I take you on the tour, I want to talk to you a little bit about the main influences. And the main influences come from Koos Verhoef and MC Escher. Koos has been a father figure to me for over 40 years. Koos Verhoef is a mathematician, and he frequently met with MC Escher at the Mathematics Center in Amsterdam, where he worked. With regards to my sculpture work, I'll have to show you a little bit here. Where music is composed of a language with 12 notes, I compose in a different language with 12 directions. And there are 12 directions in the cubic lattice space. So I create motifs, and those motifs that are composed are developed further using symmetry principles such as rotation, reflection, reversal, and scaling. And the results of these motifs that are developed are closed lattice path structures. And what I try to do is to show you the beauty of symmetry. And quite uniquely, you can see that symmetry from any perspective. So in a way, I like to compose music for the eyes. And so I will show you a couple of themes, one sculpture in detail, and I'll leave the rest for you to explore. So when I talk about themes, the first theme that I'd like to show you is polylines. And these polylines are simply vertices that are connected by edges in the lattice to form a closed path. I don't like loose ends, so all the paths are closed. The next theme that I'd like to show you is the theme of curves. And for curved sculptures, I simply interpolate a curve through key vertices in the lattice structure. By the way, if you press the blue button, you can find more info for any of these sculptures. You can see some that I've actually built. Some of them are large, and some of them are actually quite small. So the next theme is the theme of knots. And this is a particularly interesting knot. It's a figure eight knot. And I will show you that by choosing your perspective, you can make the world flip upside down. So if I choose this perspective, the sculpture looks like it has 2 feet and head pointing to the sky. But if I simply change my perspective a little bit, it'll actually look like the world is now upside down, standing on its head with the feet pointing to the sky. And unfortunately, these days, this phenomena is not only related to sculptures, but I will not go there. So I'll show you the next subject, which is the subject of spirals. And here with these spirals, these spirals actually also form a knot. So sometimes in these sculptures, you can have the combination of multiple mathematical themes, in this case, spirals and knots. The next subject is the subject of the Möbius ribbons or sculptures. And so these are single-sided surfaces. And again, press the blue button and you can explore that. Another category is the category of fractals. And this is a Pythagorean fractal tree, originally designed by Koos Verhoef in the early 90s. And Koos and I built this first tree in 1992. And I'm currently building one in bronze that is about 5 foot tall. So the last subject I'd like to show you is the subject of optical illusions. And here we see two pictures of the same sculpture. The picture on the left suggests that these are two linked squares, and the picture on the right suggests that it is not at all two objects. So illusions can fool us. And here we actually see a picture of that sculpture. So the last sculpture I'll show you is an ode to M.C. Escher. And there is a story behind that, but I'll let you discover that by pressing the blue button a little bit later on. So this was a very quick tour of the virtual version of the MoMath gallery. I hope you enjoyed it, and maybe we can show a little bit more in the after party.
All right. Thank you so much, Anton, for your work in helping to create this gallery and in continuing to support it and give tours and giving us a little taste of it tonight. With that, we'll move on now. I'd like to bring up our next guest, which is Alex Kontorovich. Alex is a professor of mathematics at Rutgers, but he also is this year serving as the distinguished visiting professor for the public dissemination of mathematics at MoMath. He's been doing wonderful programs for us. He's been a dear friend and colleague for many years now. Please join me in welcoming Alex Kontorovich.
Thank you, Cindy, and welcome everyone. I hope you're enjoying the evening so far. I have just a few moments of your time. I wanna show you something. So this is, I wanna share with you this video. I don't know if you can see. Can everyone see what's happening here?
Yes.
Yeah, so this is a video that I shot with some of my graduate students at Rutgers. They have something called a pizza seminar. And this is actually a dry run for an event that was supposed to happen at MoMath. Hopefully, as many of you realize, what we're doing is we're taking the crust off of a pizza, off of a pizza pie, and laying it across four other pies. And what you'll notice is that it spans three of those pies and about 14% of that fourth pie. So that's, of course, 3.14, which is what pie is. Now, so the plan was to take this this activity and bring it to the museum, which usually looks much more like what you'll see in the slideshow. Lots of kids playing around, everyone touching everything, physical exhibits, and really enjoying themselves. This was planned for Pi Day. Now, Pi Day, of course, is March 14th. And as you just heard Cindy say, that was March 13th, was the last day that the museum was open. So in fact, we did not get to do our Pi activity this year. We're gonna save it, hopefully, this coming year or the one after. But that video, you know, we took it just for fun, and I threw it up on Twitter, and it ended up being viewed by 5 million people. And thousands of them were writing in and saying things like, oh my God, for the first time, I actually understand what pi is. And so this is where MoMath really has an incredible service that it can provide to the broader community, because there's so much low-hanging fruit. There's so much demand and so much desire for some really beautiful activity that's really fun and elementary and accessible, and brings the joy of mathematics to people who only see mathematics in school, and it's a source of frustration and so on. So it's really very important that people have a place where they can go, used to be physically, and enjoy things that look beautiful and things that are full of color and full of light and for kids to touch and play. And that's really what the museum is and has been about since its inception. Now, we aren't just here tonight to enjoy mathematics, of course. There's another component, which you've already seen Cindy show this animation. But mathematics, we're not just here to celebrate mathematics. We also have to make sure mathematics at MoMath continues. And so as you see, we have this 3D animation of mathematics, but now we have to discuss the thing that keeps the museum running, which is a bit of fundraising. So we'd like to open our text to pledge. This is the phone number. So it's 361, which is 19 squared for those of you that are interested, and 314 for pi and 2020. And so all you do is you text your name, Annie Hypatia, $50, and the amount will appear here. And those of you who, if you want to follow along, there's a link. Let's see. So the link is text.momath.org. That's the text to pledge. And so again, thank you very much for that that donation. So the museum, as we were just saying, closed down on March 13th. Oh, wonderful. Ah, they're coming in. Fantastic. Fantastic. So it works. And on March 13th, we completely closed down the physical component of the museum. Wow, 5,000. Fantastic. Thank you. And continued running immediately all of the programming that we've been doing for the last however many months it's been since March. Everything is virtual. As you heard from Cindy, we're reaching 100,000 people, hundreds of thousands of people in all 50 states, in 100 countries, all around the world. It used to be we could only reach the people who could walk through the doors, New Yorkers or people who, wow, fantastic, fantastic. This is, we're really making a huge contribution to the museum's operating ability. So the fixed costs don't go anywhere. The rent doesn't go anywhere. The staff are still being paid. The programs are still being put on. If you notice, all of the programs, even if there's an entry fee, $10, $15, there's always an option for, hey, if you can't pay it, that's okay. Just register for free. And the museum is really reaching out to, fantastic, another 10,000 pi. Wonderful, wonderful. The programming has continued without any pause, and people are just making this a part of their regular lives. So this semester, as the visiting professor, I'm teaching a course on the history of math. And for the last couple of weeks, we've been exploring things like what did the Pythagoreans do? A few weeks ago, we discussed Euclid and the parallel postulate. And last night, we computed the distance to the sun and to the moon and the diameter of Earth, and all without leaving our homes. And this is what the ancient Greeks managed to do 2,300 years ago, which suggested to them the theory of heliocentrism, that actually we go around the sun and not the other way around. All of this can be done completely just with the power of your mind and not any calculation, no spaceships, no telescopes. And people are coming. There are kids that are coming to these lectures of all ages, and they're just really, it's becoming a community. There's an online community of people for whom this is their regular Monday night activity or Tuesday night activity, Wednesday night. There are so many different kinds of events. We have Ask a Mathematician Anything event where people can log on for free and just throw random questions, whatever it is that they happen to think of. And we do the best we can at answering them. We have another series that's for parents. So it's called Homework Help for Parents. So parents can log on and ask something. You know, my kid's teacher is showing this and I'm too embarrassed to ask the kid, how does this actually work? And what are we supposed to do here? This is really absolutely astounding contributions. Thank you so much. We're at 358,000 already. I don't want to take much more of your time at all. Cindy, are you able to add the table proceeds?
I will in a minute, but did you want to mention the special incentive?
There is one more special incentive. All right, so for the next maybe two or three people, if you can throw in, if you can find a way, incredible, incredible. Well, I was going to say if you can find a way to throw in another $1,000, there's another 100,000 coming in. Can we say for the next contribution of 10,000 or more, we would like to throw in one of these, where you saw MoMath and fundraising, the 3D word. You can choose any two words of your choice. That's amazing. We're about to hit 500,000. Any two words of your choice that have the same number of letters, and MoMath will print for you. Will print for you one of your choosing. So the next maybe two that come in at 10,000 or more, we would be very happy to do that for you. Let's see if we can get just a couple more contributions. Wonderful. There's some wonderful contributions coming in. Thank you all so much. We're over the 500,000 mark. Cindy, can we add the table proceeds to that?
I just did. It may take a moment to come through.
Oh, there it is. Wow, 620,232. That brings us to $1.1 million for the museum. That is absolutely amazing. Thank you all so much. Really, from the bottom of my heart, you're adding to the entropy of mathematics in the world, and I couldn't thank you more. Let us move on to the next component of the evening. The text-to-pledge will continue all night long. If you want to come back to the website text.momath.org or text the number 361-314-2020 with your name and a number, you can continue doing that. But in order to keep things moving along, I'd like to introduce our next distinguished speaker, Dr. Julie Gerberding. She's currently the Executive Vice President and Chief Patent Officer at Merck, and was formerly the director of the CDC, the U.S. Center of Disease Control and Prevention. Just 1 month after September 11th, the terrorist attacks in 2001, there were several reports of anthrax, potentially fatal disease of the lungs in Florida and Washington, D.C. And there was a widespread panic across the country, and people became wary of opening their mail. And as the NCID spokesperson, it was Dr. Gerberding's job to address the public, and very many credit her for calming a very frightened nation. She appeared confident in press conferences, and she explained the complicated situation in clear, concise, and honest terms. Barely 6 months as chair of the CDC, Dr. Gerberding's skills were once again put to the test when the U.S. faced another mysterious illness, and this time it was this severe acute respiratory syndrome, SARS. So although the disease originated in Asia, with China hit particularly hard, it soon became apparent that this disease was going to travel. And by May of 2003, there were almost 7,000 cases reported in almost 30 countries. And Dr. Gerberding and the CDC worked tirelessly and very quickly with international researchers in understanding what caused the virus, how it spread, and how it could be stopped. And again, in this trying time, Dr. Gerberding was the voice of reason for the American public. Dr. Gerberding has very many awards and honors. If I spent all night telling you what they were, we'd never get to hear from her. She's been named one of Time Magazine's top 100 innovators of the year, and on many occasions was named Forbes Magazine's top 100 most powerful women. So please help me welcome Dr. Julie Gerberding, and Manjul Bhargava will come back to interview Dr. Gerberding.
Thanks, Alex. Appreciate it. Thank you so much, Julie, for being with us. It's a great honor. Your work, especially at this critical time, is so important for our country and for the world. As former president of vaccines at Merck, you were instrumental in increasing access to the company's vaccines to people around the world. And so I want to begin with two things that are on the minds of people everywhere today about vaccines, vaccine availability and vaccine safety. And the question is, of course, how soon can we expect a safe vaccine to be available? And who should the public listen to? Who should they trust in determining whether a COVID-19 vaccine is safe?
Thank you. And I just have to correct one small thing. I wish I was the chief patent officer at Merck, but actually I'm the chief patient officer, which is a little bit different jurisdiction. Thank you so much. I can't think that I've spent an evening with more fascination than I have in the first part of this evening. So I can tell that I'm going to be making a trip to the museum very, very soon.
Oh, wonderful to hear.
I think we're in a very difficult situation right now. We were talking in the breakout room. We have more than 770 products in development for SARS-CoV-2 around the world, including the vaccines, the antivirals, and the antibodies. And I'm sure with this many shots on goal, we're going to end up with some useful compounds. but in their effort to move everything forward urgently in a society with trust at a low point, this has created the perverse situation where more people are afraid of the treatment than they seem to be of the disease itself. And so we're in a very tragic situation. I certainly want to be cautiously optimistic that we'll have a good enough vaccine soon. That may not mean that we'll have the best vaccine first, but if we get anything, it's a little bit like Swiss cheese. If you've got one slice that has holes in it, and maybe that's social distancing, and then you put a mask on top of that and it covers some of the open space. And then if you put a partially effective vaccine on top of that, pretty soon you've created an impenetrable barrier and you really can quench the transmission of the virus. But it requires all of those things, not just one of those things. And I think that's what our population is having trouble getting their head around. We want to believe that there's going to come this magic day when suddenly 300 million doses of vaccine will be available and that's it, we can all go back to work and things will return to normal. That is absolutely not going to happen. I think we'll be fortunate if we get a helpful vaccine early next year, more than likely by the time it rolls out and the doses are made available and trust builds, assuming that it proves to be as safe as we would hope it would be in order to be approved or released. It'll take several months before we can really see the benefit, particularly if it's a two-dose vaccine, because of course, two doses are spaced in time and a large proportion of people, from our experience, aren't going to come back for their second dose, even under the best of times. So we've got to be patient with experiencing the value of a vaccine. And that's optimistic. You know, in my experience with Merck, we've lost a lot of vaccines, mostly in early phases, but we've lost some vaccines in phase three after testing them in hundreds and thousands of people. Ended up with an HIV vaccine that didn't work, ended up with a Staph aureus vaccine that didn't work. So I think when we talk about vaccines and vaccine optimism from the standpoint of a pretty experienced company, we're pretty humble because we recognize that while we want to be hopeful and work aggressively, we don't know what we need to know until the data are all in. So in that context, building trust is really tough. And it's made especially tough in an environment where the people leading the communication from the topmost layers are not mathematicians. And I'm saying that tongue in cheek because I think what we are really experiencing is a complete ignorance of math and the math necessary to understand the spread of the disease, the severity of the disease, and the probability of the various opportunities to interfere with the disease is just simply not present in a lot of the political communications that are going on. So we're not teaching our public to understand how to think about the pandemic. And then we're alarming them by emphasizing the speed of our vaccine development, but not talking enough about all the steps that have to go into assessing the safety and making sure that all the I's are dotted and the T's are crossed before it's made available. So we're in the hole right now. And I think we've lost a lot of confidence. So in a sense, I hope we can push a reset button and, you know, kind of start the communication all over again when the vaccines do become available. And my best hope is that that will happen with an evolving leadership and the things that will help us reset people's expectations. Mm-hmm.
Well, given the public health crisis that we're experiencing, we know that the scientific community and the biopharmaceutical industry has been under a lot of pressure and have been working at an unprecedented pace to develop a vaccine. And so instead of the normal development timeline of a few years, it's being replaced, we're looking at maybe a few months. Because of this pressure, will there be any impact on safety and on durability of the vaccine? The vaccines that come out?
Yeah, so, you know, the fastest a vaccine has ever gone from start to full licensure is 4 years. And that was a mumps vaccine that Merck actually created many, many years ago. The mumps, probably many of you received. And then recently, under emergency situation in West Africa, we helped develop a vaccine called Erbivo against Ebola. And that ended up taking about 5 years until it was fully approved by the FDA, even though that was an emergency and everybody was collaborating in that case to try to bring the vaccine forward as well. So to look at where we are going from January to say November or even January, let's say it's 12 months, that really is unprecedented. But it's not really a completely fair comparison because there has been a lot of work on coronavirus vaccines in the background because of SARS and because of MERS. So we're not really starting from scratch like we have with some of the other infections. We have quite a bit of experience under our belts. And we also have a much better scientific platform at our disposal than we ever did when we were back making mumps vaccine. So I think there are reasons why the timeline is sped up. But when you look at how we are speeding the process, the speed is not coming by taking safety shortcuts. The speed is coming by doing more things in parallel, by planning for the manufacturing before we even know if the vaccine is going to work. So companies like Merck and many others are investing hundreds of millions of dollars in our manufacturing. And Merck, for example, hasn't even got its vaccine into phase three yet. And yet we've made these investments because we know that that's a big time, you know, time sink. If you wait till approval and then you start investing in manufacturing, that takes a long time. So that's one of the main ways. There are also things that the regulatory agencies are doing to tell us what we need to bring forward in our dossiers to help harmonize the protocols so that everybody is building from the same basic approach, which means it's easier to compare one vaccine to another if we have to make those comparisons going forward. So I could go on, but I think you get the picture. We're collaborating across the board to accelerate the kind of nuts and bolts of moving things along the pipeline. But when it comes to the actual clinical trials, assessing the people who are in the trial, documenting the safety of the vaccine, we have made a formal pledge. We will not take safety shortcuts. We will follow the full FDA guidance to assure safety. And knock on wood, everyone who's in this process will adhere to those guidelines.
Well, thank you. No, that's very reassuring, of course. People may not be aware of the vaccine development process and the work that's underway. Can you tell us a little bit about the process and the current efforts and candidates that are underway towards a vaccine?
It's a long process, so I'll just summarize very quickly. You know, the first step is the biology. And we were fortunate to get the genome from China pretty early in the game. But that is really just the first step. Then you have to choose the antigen that you think is the most likely. And actually, the vast majority, almost all of the vaccines in development right now are all using the same spike protein. It's very immunogenic in basically everybody's hands. So I think we have a molecule that turns the immune system on. What that will result in remains to be seen. But once you kind of hone in on something that looks like a good candidate, you have to go through a lot of chemistry to formulate it. Depending on the platform you're using, there are all kinds of bioprocessing steps that have to go on. And then you have to do studies in cell culture. And then you do studies in animal models. And then eventually you do a phase one study, which is just a tiny little safety study in a few number of people. Then you do a phase two study, which tries to help you get the right dose. And then you do the full scale phase three studies that are taking 30, 40, 50,000 people and following them for a long period of time. Once that phase is done, usually you have what you need to submit for approval. But in the case of vaccines, there's a phase four, which means you still monitor people over much longer periods of time to monitor for late side effects or adverse events, as well as to monitor the durability of the protection that the vaccine is hopefully going to provide.
Right. How many serious candidates are there for a vaccine?
Well, there are seven right now that are in the running, I would say. I hesitate to comment on the Russian vaccine or the Chinese vaccine because I really don't know anything about the vaccines.
In the U.S., there are seven that are serious.
Yeah, I would say there are seven that are, you know, being looked at and invested in broadly. There are others that look interesting, but they are earlier in the game. And I think until we really understand how much protection a spike protein-based vaccine provides, how long does any protection last, and how robust is that protection if this RNA virus evolves or drifts over time, we have so much to learn that we always, that's why I say cautiously optimistic, because as I said, you know, we've been humbled by lessons that we've learned the hard way in the past. So while we want to create transparency about what's going on, I'm very reluctant to hype the prospects of a vaccine, because I think we need to let the science lead that conversation.
And of course, one of these efforts is at Merck, where you are, is that right?
Yeah, we have two vaccines. They're very early. One is in clinical trials, and one is in clinical phase one, and one is heading there soon. We also have an antiviral that we're excited about. That molecule is in a more advanced stage of development. And as I said in the breakout room, I think it's important to think about antivirals, because if we could reduce the mortality from the seriously ill infections or prevent people from going on to develop the more severe stages, we really take the edge off of this disease. And in a sense, good antiviral therapies are game changers. If we can find some that are effective and safe, and also are robust in terms of any evolution in the virus over time.
Well, maybe I can ask you a question from Immunology 101, but what enables us to have immunity to a virus? We keep hearing about antibodies as well as about T cells and B cells and interferons, all of which play a role in fending off a virus. Can you clarify for us what each of these are and which of these new vaccines aim to develop in the body?
It is the most fascinating part of medicine. And, you know, I grew up when HIV was evolving in San Francisco. So, you know, I got immunology 101 the hard way early on. But I think, you know, we look at two kinds of immunity with vaccines. One is the antibody that is a marker that the immune system sees the vaccine and recognizes that it's foreign and creates an antibody to it. And that is a useful part of the immune system. But to make sure that the next time down the road, if you come in contact with the real virus, that your body remembers that, it's best to have a second form of immunity, the cell-mediated immunity, which is more durable, more robust, and in a sense, more powerful. And generally, you want to see that cell-based immunity evolve from your vaccine. There is a concern with this SARS coronavirus 2 that when we look at the clinical disease and we see all this kind of immune activation that causes the severe lung disease, but also the cardiovascular disease, the strokes, the toes that aren't getting circulation, the inflammatory condition in children, the theoretical worry is that if you're vaccinated, and then down the road, you see the virus, your immune system might overreact. And that would be, you know, what we call immune enhancement. And we haven't seen that, as far as I know, in the vaccine trials that are underway right now. But that's why the FDA put a strong caveat in their guidance for approval to make sure that we looked for and had sufficient information to follow people long enough to see what happens if they're later exposed to the virus. As I said, it's theoretical. I don't want people to leave thinking, oh my goodness, there's another reason to be afraid of the vaccine. This is an anticipated concern for just about every vaccine, but it is something in this situation because of the inflammatory nature of COVID-19 that we're watching for with especially careful eye.
T cells and B cells, are those also the target of vaccines is to develop the antibody?
The B cells make the antibodies and the T cells participate in that, but they're also responsible for the more durable long-term protection that we're looking for. So yeah, it's helpful to have healthy T and B cells when you're looking for a robust vaccination. And it's an issue because, of course, the people who are at the highest risk of severe disease include the elderly people and others whose immune systems aren't as healthy as they are in young college students, for example. And so in those people, often it's this, the T cell system that doesn't work as well. So we don't know yet how effective some of the formulations of vaccine will actually be in more senior people, but all the more reason why we need to make sure that we have broad-based population immunization, because you know, the more people who can't transmit, the faster we'll get this thing under control.
Right. Well, we've heard a lot about the words herd immunity and what that means and what it's gonna take for all of us to be safe. Can you tell us a little bit about what herd immunity means and how many people have to attain immunity for it to be an effective deterrent for the spreading of the virus?
Yeah, so let me first say that the fact that the conversations about herd immunity are so wrong just indicates to me how important MoMath is, how important that improving the numeracy of our population has to be, as people really can't comprehend what we're talking about with herd immunity because they can't conceptualize the numbers and how they interact. You know, the amount of population immunity necessary to call something herd immunity depends on the virus and how transmissible it is. So for example, with measles, which is one of the most transmissible viruses that I've ever seen in my career, the herd immunity to get population level protection for measles is above 90%. So that's why if you have a few people not vaccinating their children, you can still get really important outbreaks of measles. With this virus, we're not sure what the level of herd immunity is. The best models suggest at least 70% of the population needs to be immune, either because they've had the disease or because they've been vaccinated. 70% is still a pretty high number, but it's achievable. And that has to be looked at in terms of where do we start? Right now, certainly at the best estimate of missed cases, et cetera, I mean, we're well under 20% in the US, probably closer to 10%. Although the way things are going, it won't be long before we are at 20%, I fear. But you know, if we're starting at 20% and then we bring a vaccine into the equation, and let's say we're really lucky and the vaccine is 70% after two doses, but we have to subtract from that the number of people who won't get the second dose. And that's just human nature. And then we have to multiply that by the percent of people who won't get vaccinated because they're afraid or they want to wait or, you know, they're uncomfortable with what we don't know yet. So the prospects of picking up, you know, another 50 or 60% of the population quickly are pretty slim to none, I would say. So it's going to take a long time to build up a vaccine-based population threshold sufficient to totally quench this transmission. But that's where, you know, kind of getting back to some of the things Eric was talking about, you know, we talk about a test and trace strategy, but there's also sort of this, the concept of monitoring or of detecting and quenching in a more segmented way. So in other words, right now we know what constitutes a hotspot. We can pretty much look at a situation and say, yeah, that's a hotspot. That has a high potential for spread. Confinement, crowding, loss of contact. And when you're seeing those kinds of situations, those are the situations where testing routinely is important because either you're, you know, examining a hotspot that's actually happening, or you're in there monitoring a high-risk situation before it evolves. So nursing homes, for example, cruise ships, prisons, places where we know this virus can move very, very quickly. And I think we're beginning to see in certain kinds of college campus environments where the students are not cooperating with social distancing that we have similar hotspots. And I think that's the justification for all the testing that's going on college campuses. But you know, you don't have to test everyone. You need to use some common sense about where we apply those tools. And the more we can reinforce that with apps and, you know, other means of identifying who has been next to whom in the course of that, we could narrow the aperture of the people that we need to concentrate on with testing. Those are also the people that should go first for vaccines after the health workers have been vaccinated. So there's a rationale of saying it's not one size fits all. Let's concentrate on, you know, putting the flames out that are potentially going to explode in the forest fire before it gets that far.
Well, following up on that, there are many questions on how a vaccine, once available, will be distributed. How can we ensure that a vaccine, once available, is equitably available to all, particularly to people from socially and economically disadvantaged backgrounds?
Well, I believe, and you can tell I have a very, very, very strong public health gene, but I believe that we have to think about this globally, because we are really only as safe as our weakest link. And so I think that participating in the global community, the COVAX mechanism that WHO has established to allow all countries to participate in accessing the pool of vaccines as they become available, is the most equitable approach we can take. And I realize that is not a nationalist point of view and the politicians will see it otherwise, but I think first and foremost, it is the frontline health workers and other essential workers, and following on them are the people that keep our society safe, because they have to be out there. And then I think we need to think about the people who are the most vulnerable. They may not be health workers, but they're the people who are driving our buses and keeping our gig economies operational so that the rest of us can stay home and have our groceries delivered, et cetera. So there's a kind of an inverse hierarchy in society that we need to think about. And that's going to be a really tough decision. I have found that in the US, the CDC's, it's called the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices, is the first stop for looking at vaccine allocation. They did a great job in 2004 when 50% of our nation's influenza vaccine was lost due to a quality issue. I was the director then, and we had to scramble around to reallocate our limited supply of vaccine to try to make sure that the senior citizens got it and frontline healthcare workers, et cetera. So ACIP is very good at thinking about those things. But the backstop to that is the National Academy of Medicine, because they can convene more broadly and bring in lots more of the diverse points of view and the stakeholder perspectives. And they have been working on this for COVID-19, for the SARS-CoV-2 vaccines, and have come up with the first pass of the phase 1, phase 2, phase 3 allocation schemes that aren't very granular yet, but I found them to be very thoughtful and in a ethically defensible, morally defensible approach that I hope we can come close to as we think about this as a nation, but also as a globe.
How will we ensure that the vaccine is available globally in an equitable manner? Will initiatives like COVAX be sufficient? Will the US be a part of COVAX? Help me counteract this. You're not part of this group, but the vaccine nationalists. How do we counteract vaccine nationalism?
There's an interesting thing, because right now the United States is not participating in COVAX, but we are. So the companies are participating in the COVAX effort. J&J is there, Merck is there. We're all contributing through our IFPMA, which is our sort of international trade association, if you will. But we are very involved in COVAX from that standpoint. And there has different buckets of work, and we're participating in all of them gladly.
We don't need our government to.
Well, you know, we do need our government. We need our government to do a lot. But, you know, it doesn't mean that we are 100% You know, it's an interesting dilemma, isn't it? Because our government, our federal government, has the money, but it hasn't really framed policies in a way that is consistent with how I think about public health policy. and they've deflected to the states the policy decisions, but the states have no money. So we've got money and no policy, and we've got policy and no money, and the matchup is not going very well for us in this country. So I hope we can get that straightened out, because it's a very perverse situation right now.
Yeah, no, it's a very important point. And on a related vaccine note, we're all hearing about a possible twindemic with both COVID-19 and the flu. Is it more or less important for people to go out and get a flu shot?
Well, you know, I would be fired from my public health credentials if I didn't advocate for a flu vaccination. So if there was ever a year to get a flu shot, this is the year. You know, the flu shot is never 100% effective, but it does help. And it certainly keeps people out of the hospital, helps keep people out of the hospital. And right now that's going to be really important if this surge continues, which I fear that it might. Flu is, as we know, very infectious. And I don't know to what extent the measures that we're taking now through social distancing and masks and hygiene, et cetera, are going to attenuate this year's flu season. But just based on what we're watching with SARS-CoV-2, I can't imagine that we're going to skip a season. So I think we have to be prepared for two epidemics at once. But more importantly, for the individuals who have one and then get exposed to the other, I'm just certain that's going to really complicate care and potentially end up with even more tragic loss of life in the context of respiratory disease. So yeah, I'm concerned about it for sure.
Yeah, no, thank you for getting the message out about that. You're the best person to do that, of course.
A little passionate on that topic. And by the way, Merck does not make flu vaccines, so please do not think that I'm marketing here.
Yeah, right. Right. Yeah, a very important message. Yeah. Well, when you were the former head of the CDC, you led more than 40 public health crises. What can we learn from your experiences with other global health crises that are applicable in the current pandemic?
Well, you know, I guess I would try to summarize into two buckets. The first bucket is, I truly believe that what we're experiencing right now is not a once in 100-year problem. This is the new world that we live in, and we are going to see more serious spillovers from animal diseases, intentional diseases, or diseases of society in chaos as we go forward. So we need to do much more to invest in consistent and long-term preparedness. I think of it as national security. It's the mentality we use for national defense is a mentality and investment portfolio that we need to be thinking about for our bio defense. And we have had this kind of a funding cycle for these issues. We rev up when there's a crisis and it goes away. In fact, I co-chair a commission on global health security at CSIS, and our report just came out right before the pandemic, was entitled, Achieving Global Health Security from Crisis, Ending the Cycle of Crisis to Complacency. So just this over and over again. So one thing is recognizing that because of climate change, social chaos, crowding, travel, urbanization, and incursion, all of these factors are going to cause these infectious diseases to continue to emerge. On the other hand, I think we also need to learn the importance of communication, trustworthy communication. I'm not in the mindset to criticize anybody's communication when they're in the frying pan, but I do feel like risk communication is something that has a paradigm around it. I practiced it hours at CDC. It can be boiled down to a few simple principles, but first and foremost, if you want people to believe you, they have to believe you care. And creating that sense of genuine empathy and appreciation for what people are experiencing and what they are going through I'm actually an introvert. And when I would have to stand in front of the cameras day after day after day during the SARS outbreak, it was really hard. And the only way I could really do it was to pretend like the reporters in the room were my patients. And I was trying to explain things to them as I would if I were at the bedside trying to explain bad news to a patient that I was caring for. Because I think if you can get yourself in that mindset, you can deliver bad news. Americans can tolerate bad news, but they have to know that the person delivering it is telling the truth and is caring about the consequences of that truth and is willing to maintain their credibility and their consistency over time. So I think those are the two things that I took away from that experience. One is lean into preparedness, use your imagination because it's going to happen. And second, really learn how to bring people with you in a trusting way, because if people trust in their leadership, they'll do hard things. And we Manhattan saw that in 911. The citizens of New York City did really, really, really hard things during that period of time, but they did it because they trusted that the leadership was taking them to the place that they needed to go at that time. And without that, people don't know who to trust. And when the information is hard, mathematical as it is in this case, but when the information is hard and they don't have the framework and the help to understand it, they just resort to black and white and rely only on how the person that is in their peer group on social media sees the situation. So you get these kind of echo chambers of misinformation and mythology that get perpetuated. And once that happens, it's really, really hard to break through it.
Great. Well, thank you. That's a wonderful and inspirational way to wrap up. We will get through this, and with your leadership, we'll definitely get past this. And thank you so much, Julie, for this informative session.
Well,
it's been an honor and pleasure having you here today.
Thank you to the people who support MoMath, because I, as I said, I've learned something really important tonight, and this is so foundational to health and our society that it's a wonderful, wonderful organization. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Julie. We hope you'll come visit the physical museum, of course, once we're past this. Yeah. Thank you so much again.
Thank you.
Thank you. And now I understand Nate is here, is that right? Wonderful. It's great to see you again, Nate. The last time we saw each other was 4 years ago at this very same gala for the museum.
It feels like both 4 days ago and 40 years ago, not 40
right.
ago. Yeah.
Thanks so much for gracing us again during another pivotal election year. Just to remind everyone, Nate Silver is the founder and editor-in-chief of 538.com. He's a renowned statistician who predicts the outcomes of baseball games, as I see from here. Yeah, and of course, of elections. And of course, we all have predictions, but he actually does so correctly a vast, vast majority of the time. That's what sets him apart from the rest of us mortals. So it's an honor to have you with us, Nate. And because we had you with us 4 years ago, I guess the natural question that we all want to ask you is, well, what's different from 4 years ago? You were with us 4 years ago. What differences have you been seeing this election year? Statistically and otherwise, from when we saw you last during the previous presidential election?
So it might or might not be different. We have Trump with the roughly 10 to 15% chance of winning, and 10 to 15% chances come up, and there's no kind of law of averages. So just because that came up last time doesn't mean it will or won't come up this time. Mm-hmm. But it's a different kind of race for a couple of reasons. I think number one, Trump has a bigger deficit than he had against Clinton. He's currently behind Biden by around 10 points in national polls. The swing states are tighter, more like 7 points. That's a fairly big deficit to overcome. In contrast to 2016, it's been a fairly stable race in terms of, I mean, it's been a crazy election, right? But the polls have been stable. There are not very many undecided voters. So it's not a case like 2016 where Trump could just win the undecideds and then leap past Hillary in Wisconsin. Trump actually needs the polls to be wrong, or for people who are currently committed to Biden to change their mind in the last 14 days. That can happen. There are examples of bigger polling errors than 2016. In 1948, for example, Dewey did not defeat Truman. but it's challenging. And challenging, especially, by the way, I mean, the election is in 14 days in one sense, right? But 35 million people have already voted. In some states, half of the 2016 turnout has already sent in mail ballots or voted early. So that makes it a little bit harder maybe to kind of come back at the last minute. At the same time, there is a lot of uncertainty related to the world that we live in. There is a lot of news. Most of that news does not seem to affect the polls very much, but we're not in a time when we can just kind of say, oh, it's a bunch of fake stories, right? Obviously, mail voting is something which is very different. On the one hand, most studies say that mail voting increases turnout, which could help Democrats because they vote more by mail in this climate where Trump has disparaged mail voting. On the other hand, there are a lot of things that can go wrong when you vote by mail, where your ballot might get lost, it might not get counted if you don't follow the proper procedure. And so there's this ballot spoilage rate with mail voting that could affect things at the margin potentially. Our model assumes that that votes are counted and that kind of courts aren't doing anything especially unusual. That yes, if it's very close, then courts will have rulings, which will probably be fairly partisan, but they wouldn't intervene in an election that Biden clearly won. So there are uncertainties out there, and it kind of contrasts against this remarkable stability in the polling. And so, you know, people I think are appropriately a little bit nervous or anxious.
Right. How much can election trends change in 14 days, given what is the proportion of mail-in ballots that have been mailed in this time compared to previous years? Can the election trends really change in 14 days?
So it's way, way ahead of any previous year, right? I think maybe like three times more ballots have been cast already this year than in the past. Because it's new, then we kind of don't really have enough data to really study it, right? Maybe it turns out in this new paradigm where, you know, 70% of ballots are cast before election day that actually things don't move very much at all. With that said, in 2016, we had a development that occurred in the final 10 days of the race, which was the Comey letter about Clinton's emails that reopened that up as a story. And that moved the polls by about 3 points. So the way Trump would win would probably not be by having some gigantic polling error or by drawing the race to a tie, but by closing the gap and then having a modest polling error. And that's basically what happened in 2016. So that's where his 10 to 15% chance comes from, is like, it's plausible. You would not bet on it at even money or even at less than even money. But stranger things have happened. People I think got spoiled by how accurate the polls were in years like 2008, 2012. I mean, there have been years in the past where they were off. I'd also say if you're someone who is like, I assume people on this call are the type of people who will probably vote no matter what, right? Even if Biden wins, then the margin really matters a lot. Whether people think Biden just skirted by or that it was a big mandate against Trump, right? How many seats Democrats win in the Senate, if they win the Senate at all, would be very important to how much Biden would be able to get done. And so it's not like, even if somehow Trump got down to a 5% chance on election day, number one, if you're someone who's mathematically inclined, 5%'s pretty big, right? We've all been taking all these precautions against COVID. Most of us have probably a 1% or thereabouts infection fatality rate with COVID, or a bit lower, older, higher if you're older, right? But like, it's quite rational to like not take that 1% chance of dying from COVID. Or I know people who have long COVID, or the chance of long-term illness, probably not super high, but it's material relative to the stakes, right? And so, people on this call should know that like, even if Trump's chances dwindle further, you need to take kind of small probabilities seriously.
Right. Are polls more or less accurate than in previous years, given the world we live in these days?
We don't know. I mean, in the long run, there's not any long-term trajectory either way, that polls are roughly as accurate as they've been historically. I mean, in theory, polls should be getting...
They should be getting better, right?
...less accurate, because like, if people are not at home as much, right, they don't answer strangers' phone calls as much. Ironically, COVID, people are at home more, and therefore response rates in polls may be higher. So it may be like the only good thing to come out of COVID is like, plus, oh, I should say that all the science that comes out of COVID will be, in the long run, hopefully very good, right? But in the short run, the fact that you have higher polling response rates is an irony, I guess. But yeah, look, whether pollsters are correctly calculating the impact of mail voting is hard to know, right? Because it used to be that like both parties would use mail voting about equally. So maybe you get too many in-person voters, too many mail voters, but it wouldn't necessarily affect the overall composition of your sample, right? Now, when you have Democrats saying overwhelmingly, I'm going to vote by mail, and Republicans saying I'm going to vote in person on November 3rd, then if you kind of get that ratio wrong, then your poll could be pretty far off. So it's a source of uncertainty.
Right, right. Now, we have a question from Pete Miller, who will be our musical guest this evening after we're done chatting. He's noting that lots of people are betting on the presidential election this year. And he was wondering, have you ever considered using betting markets to improve your forecasts?
No, I think betting markets are pretty dumb for politics. I mean, obviously markets in general are hard to beat. The problem with markets for political events is that you don't have like a professional class of traders, right? You have people who are kind of recreational traders who kind of once every 4 years might make a bet, right? And usually they're kind of led by the conventional wisdom plus their intuition. But if you're not like someone who's trained to do this, then your intuition might not be much good. I think people have an issue with like, people trust their gut too much in areas where they have no experience, right? Your gut, when your gut's actually useful, it's from experience. It's from saying, okay, I have sized up versions of this problem before. And so I can make a good approximation based on my experience, right? That's what, like if you play poker, right? I'm a poker player among other things, right? Then your gut's quite valuable, right? But like someone who is like only making a trade once every 4 years, they're probably thinking, oh, in 2016, Trump was down in the polls and he won, right? And they really, really, really weight that one data point, but it's still just one data point, right? So I think probably that, the best thing to do if you care about the election is to vote, right? If you do want to engage in those markets, figure out what kind of people's biases are in the sense of cognitive biases, Daniel Kahneman, whatnot, right? What the kind of emotional triggers are, right? People really overweight the most recent event in a series of events, and they really kind of try to avoid experiencing the same trauma twice, right? So to some extent, the fact that, you know, betting markets show a closer race than polls do might even be kind of a contrarian indicator, you know?
Right. Right. Very good. Well, that's a good note to end on. Please vote, everyone. And thank you so much, Nate, for joining us with your insights.
Please support MoMath. Yeah, great to talk to everybody.
Yeah, absolutely. And we hope to see you again before 4 years. Hopefully when this is all passed, we can actually meet in person. So, thanks again, Nate. Nate Silver, everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nate.
Thank you.
Thank you, folks.
Hi. Thank you, Nate, Manjul. And I have to say that my introduction here was going to be for Pete Muller, which I had fully expected was going to be simply a video that he had pre-created, but Pete loves meeting people, he loves getting together with people, and it turns out he seems to have snuck his way into the proceedings, so my script is a little bit adjusted, so I'm going to kind of wing this. I'd introduced myself to many of you before, but some of you not. I am Tim Nissen, I'm the Associate Director here at the National Museum of Mathematics, and I'm here to introduce the musical portion of the song of the event. Pete Muller is a singer-songwriter, philanthropist, and oh yes, a very successful hedge fund executive. In fact, it was while composing music for a rhythmic gymnastics team that led Pete to see that his talent for numbers could be useful in figuring out capital markets. He founded and currently guides the Mathematically Driven Investment Fund, Process-Driven Trading. Pete has played on the New York City subway platforms and stages all around the world. And his original song, San Diego, When You Coming Home, reached number 27 on the Billboard Adult Contemporary chart in March 2020. Pete will be performing an original piece. As I said, this is pre-recorded. And as he had supposedly a conflict of interest, which he tells you about in the video, Pete has performed at most of our galas. And we're very pleased he is here. He recorded this in one take as if it were a live performance. Now, while this will represent the nominal end of our gala, for those of you who want to stick around for a less formal virtual setting where we can all mix and mingle and where everyone can chat, please join us after Pete's song for our after party that we call The Aftermath. And it turns out this time we're going to have a special guest. Pete will attend as well. So, take it away, Pete.
Hi, folks. It's Pete Muller. I'm coming to you virtually from Santa Barbara. I am literally phoning it in. I was going to do this live, but then I got this crazy invite to go hang out at Kelly Slater's Surf Ranch. So I asked Cindy if I could do this video in advance. I typically do a song every year at the MoMath benefit. Typically get to see many of you in person, which is really fun. And the song talks about the guests that we have at the benefit and usually something that's going on in the world. So that's what I've gone for on this. Trying to do a shout out to Julie Gerberding and Eric Schmidt. Thank you guys for being honored guests. Thank you, Nate Silver. And here we go. This song is called The Other Side. I meditate, and then I log on to 538. Reload my page to check Nate Silver's odds. Our country is not in great shape. We built a trap we can't seem to escape. I wonder, did we offend the gods? America wasn't always like this. Let's take a minute and reminisce about when a person's character really mattered. When we used to disagree with a little bit more empathy, the idea of civil discourse has been shattered. I'm gonna stop reading my news feed. There's no way today to cross the great divide. But I will not give up on this country, 'cause I know what's waiting on the other side. Sorry, I forget. But I hear you're some sort of epidemiology queen. Now, we all appreciate the work. You've got your people doing at Merck. And we're all hoping that you can find that vaccine. Eric Schmidt, this next verse is for you. Maybe there's something that you can do. And if you could, I really wish you would. World is going through upheaval. It's not enough to not do evil. Sometimes you need to do good. Tell Google that. I'm gonna stop watching the TV. There's no way today to cross the great divide. And I will not give up on my country. We will find our way to the other side. Watching this virtually, there's a number on your screen that says, I don't know what the number is actually, but you can text to it and donate to MoMath. It's a great cause, and I hope you do that. The money will be put to good use, and you'll feel good about it. All right, we got more song for you. Now, I'm not a fan of bureaucracy, but I used to trust the CDC. Now they're under attack from White House minions. I hope that it's not too late to teach people to differentiate between real science and opinions. Herd immunity or mask mandates, answers vary across the so-called United States. Every day brings another contradiction. Nation with such great wealth should just do better at public health. Let's trust science, not fiction. I'm gonna stop reading my news feed. There's no way today to cross the great divide. I will not give up on this country, 'cause I know what's waiting on the other side. The other side, the other side, the other side. this little song. I hope I get to see you guys in person next year. Don't forget to donate. Thank you to Julie and Eric and Nate for helping MoMath to celebrate and raise some money for a very good cause. I wish this event wasn't virtual, you see, because I really miss all of your company. And here's where I would wait for your applause.
Hi, guys.
Hey, there he is.
Here I am.
In person.
In person. Hey, at,
great to see you.
You can see the surf ranch behind me. It's a really crazy place. So I'm sorry I couldn't be there in person this year, but I'm glad the song seemed to have worked.
You do not disappoint. Thank you so much. You are a true friend of MoMath. Thank you so much for taking the extra effort to be here under those sunny skies. Are you going to join us for the after party? Do you have any time to stick with us?
I unfortunately don't think I can hang. I have a 3.5 hour car ride back to Santa Barbara, and I need to get in the car and maybe I can see my kids before they go to bed.
Well,
it's hooky today.
That, as I said, is a conflict of interest, and it's just a testimony to just how much you love so many people that you just can't be in that many places at one time.
I try as much as I can, but if you got me for 5 minutes, if you need me for something.
Cindy, maybe we can rejigger things a little bit.
I think we're ready to thank everyone for being here. And for those who want to stick around for some more casual conversation, we would be delighted if you stick around for the after party. I know Pete may stay for a minute or two. Julie may join us for a few minutes. Everybody will be unmuted and able to chat. And let me just thank everyone for joining us tonight, for your support of MoMath, for helping us make a wonderfully successful event, even in the face of a new reality that we're all living with. Thank you all, and please stick around if you'd like, and if not, we hope to see you again at the museum at some point in the future, and at this event maybe again next year. Thank you for coming, and thank you, Julie and Eric and Nate, for your really interesting words. It's wonderful.